Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Wealth of Refugees, How Displaced People Can Build Economies, by Alexander Betts, read by Jennifer M. Dixon. Publisher's note, this audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. 1. Introduction. Human displacement is one of the defining issues of the 21st century. Amid oppression, violence, and economic collapse, more people than ever are now forced to flee their homes. Most are quite literally running for their lives, abandoning villages and towns bombed, burned to the ground, or targeted by men with guns. For the first time in history, more than 80 million people are displaced, greater than 1% of humanity. Most displaced people remain within their own country, but more than 25 million are refugees, compelled to leave their country in order to survive. From Syria to Venezuela, the main cause is governments that either attack their own people or fail to prevent other terrible things happening. Such governments are unwilling or unable to ensure the most basic conditions for a dignified life, a life that you or I would think worth living. Leaving behind familiar communities and cultures, refugees face an uncertain and sometimes unwelcoming response in the countries they reach. And the scale of the challenge will soon worsen as climate change makes vast areas of the planet uninhabitable and exacerbates crisis and conflict. Of course, the ideal solution would be to address the underlying causes, ending wars, overthrowing authoritarian governments, and cutting greenhouse gas emissions would reduce displacement numbers. But the world has struggled to find solutions to these root causes, and the international community has proved deficient at replacing bad governments. Consequently, we are mostly left to address the human consequences of global insecurity, finding ways to temporarily accommodate or permanently integrate displaced people in other communities, and enabling them to live in dignity and with purpose. This too is challenging because many receiving societies are reluctant to accept large numbers of refugees, and populist politicians in rich and poor countries often exploit public concerns for electoral gain. Rather than highlighting the contribution that refugees can make to receiving societies or the moral obligation to host, politicians from the United States to Tanzania emphasize the threat to the economy, security, or identity. In this context, the question is, how can the world find ways to sustainably host growing numbers of refugees and displaced people? This question matters for the rich world. In Europe, North America, and Australasia, upholding refugee rights is critical to maintaining liberal, democratic values. To be regarded as liberal and legitimate, rich countries cannot simply turn their backs on people who flee for their lives. One important way to assist refugees is to allow them to enter the country, either by letting them arrive spontaneously as asylum seekers, or through organized resettlement programs. Asylum and resettlement in the rich world have an indispensable role to play, but they are only ever likely to be for the minority of displaced people. The overwhelming majority of displaced people do not travel to rich countries. Although some refugees embark on long and dangerous journeys, most cross the nearest border to nearby camps and cities. The biggest challenge for refugee policy is how to create meaningful and dignified lives within these mainly poor countries that are close to war zones and tyranny. This is a book about what works and what can work. It aims to be practical, relevant, and solutions-oriented. Importantly, it is evidence-based. In a policy field, refugees and migration, in which narrative, claim, and counterclaim are often made without recourse to fact, This book uses a range of social science methods to explore the kinds of policies and practices that can actually provide sustainable sanctuary to refugees and other displaced populations. It does so mainly by learning from the experience of three countries in East Africa, which, despite hosting more refugees than the whole of the European Union, EU, and more than five times as many as North America, have each adopted innovative and in some ways progressive refugee policies aimed at mutually benefiting refugees and host country citizens. The goal is not to romanticize these countries' experiences. They have been far from perfect, nor is it to suggest they can simply be replicated elsewhere. Context matters. Rather, the aim is to critically assess what has been effective and under what conditions. The search for sustainability. My starting point is three observations about trends in forced displacement and refugee movements, which are likely to endure, relating to geography, numbers, and politics. First, contrary to popular belief, most refugees are not in Europe or North America. Some 85% of the world's refugees are in low and middle-income countries. This is because such countries often neighbour crisis countries, and because they often have porous borders, meaning that the first country to which people flee is usually a neighbouring state. Most refugees do not have the means, aspiration, or freedom to travel further. They remain in camps or cities in the region they come from, and this may offer some advantages, sometimes a common language, a similar economy, and the ability to easily retain contact with the homeland. For example, Somalis fleeing to the so-called Somali region of southern Ethiopia are able to speak Somali with the host community, engage in similar income-generating activities as back home, and sometimes go back and forth to south-central Somalia to maintain farms or property. However, both refugees in such countries and the low- and middle-income countries that host them frequently face significant challenges. Refugees are usually required to reside in camps with restrictions on the right to work and their mobility. Their access to basic services, such as education and healthcare, may be inadequate. And, even close to home, they may face discrimination. It is unsurprising that a small but probably growing number choose to move onwards in search of a better life. For the countries that host them, the inequitable distribution of refugees around the world means that it is the countries with the fewest resources that bear the greatest responsibility. Although refugees often make an economic contribution to the areas that host them, and most host countries respect the right of refugees to remain on their territory, large numbers may also be perceived as a source of insecurity, economic competition, or environmental degradation. For decades, Tanzania, for example, has repeatedly argued that despite hosting hundreds of thousands of refugees, it has lacked adequate support from the international community, sometimes scaling back on refugee rights in protest. Second, numbers of forcibly displaced people and refugees are increasing, virtually year on year. The number of both displaced persons, including those displaced within their own country and across borders, and refugees, who represent a large proportion of that group, is higher than at any time since the Second World War. Most flee from chronically fragile or failed states, with over half of the world's recognized refugees from just Syria, South Sudan, and Afghanistan. But practically each year, the list of fragile and hence refugee-producing countries seems to expand. Venezuela and Yemen are among the countries that have recently gone from relative stability to societal collapse, and it will be many years before people can go home. Several factors underlie the trend in fragile states, but among them is the widening distribution of power in the international system, which is exacerbating big power rivalries between the United States, Russia, and China. These rivalries play out within small states of geostrategic importance and yet simultaneously paralyze the UN Security Council in its search for solutions. All the credible projections on the distribution of global power suggest that this trend is unlikely to abate unless China and the United States build a shared vision for responding to fragile states. And a further trend is likely to further exacerbate displacement: climate change. Anthropogenic climate change is an incontrovertible fact, and it will affect many areas of social life, which in turn have implications for migration and displacement. In extreme cases, such as natural disasters, desertification, and sinking islands, the effects on displacement will be direct. In other cases, the effect will be to amplify and exacerbate other sources of displacement, such as food insecurity and conflict. Where states are weak, climate change will have its greatest impact on displacement. Already we are seeing the effects on forced displacement. In the Northern Triangle of Central America, the surge in forced movement of people from rural communities in Honduras and Nicaragua to the US has been partly attributed to the effects of climate change on food security and its interaction with weak governance. Across the Sahel, resource competition attributable to climate change is exacerbating existing conflicts in ways that have led to displacement in Niger and the Central African Republic. Although there is nothing inevitable about future forced displacement scenarios, current trends strongly suggest that numbers will grow, possibly significantly. Third, the politics relating to refugees and migration is increasingly divisive. In Europe, North America, and Australasia, migration has steadily risen in its political salience to become one of the most important electoral issues. In some countries and regions, it has become the most important political issue for voters. The so-called European refugee crisis of 2015 to 2016 was opportunistically mobilized by populist politicians in a way that polarized societies and ushered in electoral success for the far right. In the absence of the crisis and the way in which it was politically represented, it is arguable that Brexit in the UK, as well as the rise of alternative für Deutschland in Germany, would not have taken place. In the US, the politics of immigration has shaped growing societal division and escalating xenophobia. Across the Western world, immigration has become a scapegoat issue, serving as a proxy for other unrelated social problems, such as the disappearance of labor-intensive manufacturing jobs and precarious financial markets. Regardless of how disingenuous much of the political narrative has been, the political consensus in the rich world is for strict limits on mass migration. The politics is not much more auspicious in many parts of the global South. Xenophobia and the politics of immigration are not simply rich world phenomena. Some governments observed Europe's response to the refugee crisis and have mimicked the same restrictive policies towards refugees. In 2016, observing how Europe paid off Turkey to curtail the movement of Syrians across the Aegean Sea, Kenya threatened to immediately close the Dadaab refugee camps and expel all Somali refugees as a thinly veiled means to induce greater international support. Only slightly less cynically, Concern about refugee numbers has been a key part of election campaigns at both national and municipal levels, from Colombia to Lebanon. Anti-immigration rhetoric has become a global vote winner, and asylum for the displaced is caught up in the maelstrom. There is, however, one significant difference between the positions of high-income countries on the one hand and low- and middle-income countries on the other when it comes to refugees. Relatively rich countries are at least in a position to engage in responsibility sharing with relatively poor countries that host refugees in ways that may be mutually beneficial for the states, if not always for refugees themselves. And as we will discuss in Chapter 14, the global economic recession created by the COVID-19 pandemic will exacerbate each of these trends, increasing levels of displacement and creating the conditions in which xenophobia thrives. Given these three starting observations about current and future trends, there is a need to identify approaches that can be sustainable. So, what does sustainability mean in the refugee context? I argue that it has three key elements. First, for refugees, a sustainable response must deliver their basic needs and legal entitlements. In the language of refugee governance, it needs to deliver protection, assistance, and solutions. Protection implies access to all rights under refugee and human rights law, most notably the right not to be forcibly returned to a country in which there is a serious risk of harm. Assistance means access to basic services to ensure a guaranteed minimum standard of living. Solutions relate to ensuring long-term integration within a society, whether through return to the country of origin or integration and naturalization in a new country. Second, sustainability requires a model that can maintain political support at local, national, and international levels. In order to endure over time and to avoid backlash, refugee policies need to be able to retain the backing of politicians. And to remain in power, those politicians need to be able to retain the support of their electorates and constituencies. Political authorities in hosting regions, whether at municipal or provincial level, need to be able to credibly argue that the local host community benefits from the presence of refugees. National host governments need to be able to credibly argue that hosting refugees brings benefits that are in the national interest. And the wider world of donor governments needs to derive benefits that justify the allocation of scarce national resources towards supporting host countries in other parts of the world. Third, a sustainable refugee model must be able to function at scale and endure over time. Given rising numbers, the growing number of chronically fragile and failed states in the world, and the spectre of climate change, the world needs to envisage models that can not only work for 25 million refugees today, but potentially also for significantly larger populations, perhaps even of 50 or 100 million people crossing borders because they cannot access the minimum conditions for living in safety and dignity. To deliver at scale, approaches will need to be as efficient as possible in terms of economic, social, and political costs. Reconciling these competing criteria is one of the key global policy challenges of the 21st century. The goal of this book is to begin the search for models that can resolve the challenge of providing sustainable sanctuary. The book is written from the tradition of political realism. My aim is for my research to be politically relevant. Of course, not all research on refugees and forced migration needs to be politically relevant, and critical perspectives that distance themselves from politics have an important role to play, not least in challenging power structures and questioning the way we think about the world. My aim, though, is to engage policymakers and practitioners. That does not mean that I am uncritical of dominant power structures, but that I am chiefly concerned with providing insights that are applicable to the contemporary world. Achieving relevance relies upon working from within a framework of political constraint and being explicit about the assumptions that define those constraints. From an ideal theory perspective, one might hope that it is values that ultimately shape political decisions regarding refugees. But my previous research and policy experience in the refugee field tells me that this is not always the case. And so I work from a non-ideal theory perspective, within which I regard national-level politicians to be mainly concerned with preserving power and intergovernmental politics to be mainly shaped by the pursuit of interests and power. Of course, values and norms can and do play a role, but their influence is mediated through political competition. When they are compatible with the interests of the powerful, they flourish. When they are not, they wither. This means that when I think about the refugee system, I am trying to find a model of sustainability that reconciles the moral obligation to ensure refugees' access to protection, assistance, and solutions with the constraints of world politics. In that sense, my approach might be broadly characterized as migration realism. Refugees and development. There is a growing consensus among policymakers that the best way to achieve sustainability is to help refugees to help themselves. If refugees can be empowered to meet their basic needs independently of aid and also contribute to the economy of the host society, this has the potential to benefit everyone. For refugees, it can support socio-economic inclusion and improve access to entitlements and opportunities. For host communities, it can allow them to share in the benefits of new job creation and the improvement of public services. For donor governments, it may provide a way to provide cost-effective refugee assistance at scale. This idea is encapsulated in the concept of refugee self-reliance, the notion that rather than having long-term dependence on humanitarian aid, refugees can instead be supported to gradually support themselves through external investment in the long-term economic development of the regions that host them. The UN Refugee Agency, UNHCR, defines self-reliance as the social and economic ability of an individual, a household, or a community to meet essential needs, including protection, food, water, shelter, personal safety, health, and education, in a sustainable manner and with dignity. Self-reliance is often seen as closely related to the idea of moving from relief to development or bridging the humanitarian development gap. The long-standing default model of closed refugee camps, providing refugees with indefinite access to humanitarian aid, conventionally in-kind food assistance and basic shelter, but denying their access to employment, freedom of movement, and adequate education, is now widely understood as outdated and unsustainable. It has been characterized as refugee warehousing, a denial of rights, and a waste of humanity. And that characterization is apt. Although humanitarian aid may be crucial during an emergency phase or to address vulnerabilities, it becomes problematic if it endures indefinitely, sometimes for decades, and justifies the denial of rights and the curtailment of nurturing refugees' skills, talents, and aspirations. So-called protracted refugee situations, such as the nearly 30-year-old Dadaab camps in northeastern Kenya, exemplify the misery of refugees being effectively warehoused for decades without the prospect of going home or being properly socio-economically integrated in the host society. Indeed, socioeconomic rights make up most of the entire second half of the 1951 Convention on the Status of Refugees, and yet they have been systematically undermined for decades by dominant humanitarian practices. Instead, development assistance that supports job creation, infrastructural expansion, and improvement in public services for both refugees and the host community is now widely regarded as a more sustainable pathway, offering refugees greater autonomy, dignity, and purpose, and enabling their presence to benefit surrounding communities in what are often remote and underdeveloped border regions. Politically, refugee self-reliance is often framed as win-win. The logic is that it can offer a basis for interest convergence between northern donor states and southern host states. Northern donors have an interest in reducing the need for onward migration by refugees and in creating more cost-effective models of refugee assistance. Southern host states have an interest in attracting additional development resources that can not only benefit refugees, but also support programs and projects that benefit their citizens. That interest convergence is, in turn, what unlocks greater opportunities for refugees. This basic vision for sustainability is not new. In different forms, self-reliance has been around since the interwar years of the 1920s, when Greece, faced with large numbers of refugees arriving from former Ottoman Empire states, including what is now Syria, allocated plots of land to the new arrivals and collaborated with the International Labour Organization, ILO, on the creation of agricultural work schemes that could benefit both refugees and communities in remote rural areas. In much of East Africa throughout the 1960s and 1970s, development programs in border areas with spontaneously created rural settlements were the standard response in newly independent countries such as Uganda and Tanzania. During the 1980s and 1990s, the United Nations formalized the concept of refugee aid and development, seeking to encourage donors to contribute additional development assistance to share the burden borne by refugee-hosting countries. UNHCR organized three major regional conferences built around the concept: the International Conferences in Refugees in Africa, ICARA 1 and 2 of 1981 and 1984, and the International Conference on Refugees in Central America, CIREFCA, of 1989. From the start of the millennium, there was a revival of interest in targeted development assistance as a means to achieve self-reliance, as European donor countries, in particular, became increasingly interested in managing growing levels of asylum seekers moving from regions of origin to Europe. A string of global initiatives were launched with the same goals: to overcome the relief-to-development gap and support refugee self-reliance through development assistance. From 2003 to 2005, the vehicle was UNHCR's Convention Plus initiative. From 2013 to 2015, it was the Multi-Stakeholder Solutions Alliance. Some of the ideas and language have evolved. Today, there is a much greater role for business and the private sector. Investment does not just have to come from donor states, but whether because of corporate social responsibility or, ideally, core business concerns, private investors have been recognized as a means to enhance development opportunities in refugee-hosting regions. Self-reliance has had previous incarnations such as self-sufficiency, self-supporting, and even free livers. The key development actors have also changed from ILO in the early years to the United Nations Development Programme, UNDP, during the 1980s and 1990s, to the World Bank today. But the basic concepts have shown significant continuity, and the same exemplars of the model, notably Uganda, have regularly been deployed by international organizations and donors to highlight the validity of the approach. Today, there is more consensus than ever that this self-reliance vision is the key to sustainable refugee policy. It is arguably the central organizing concept behind the UN Global Compact on Refugees, launched as a process in 2016 and agreed at the UN General Assembly in 2018, as the international community's main collective response to the aftermath of the European refugee crisis of 2015 to 2016. Although it is officially only one of four pillars, the other pillars of the compact each relate to the long-established durable solutions, repatriation, local integration, and resettlement, long elusive to the majority of refugees. And the World Bank is investing more in the approach than any development organization in history. However, it is also an idea that has been increasingly critiqued by academics for its repeated failure to deliver on its promise, its connections to supposedly neoliberal ideas, and its political instrumentalization by self-interested governments. To be clear, the basic outline of the model is one that I support and have done for two decades since witnessing the effects of denying refugees access to basic socio-economic rights. It is a model that potentially offers the best available outcomes for refugees and meets the criteria for sustainability. It is, in a sense, the only game in town for the majority of the world's refugees. But as intuitively persuasive as the approach has been, it has been equally elusive in terms of either its effective implementation or its extensive rollout across host countries. Both now and historically, very few low- and middle-income countries have adopted effective self-reliance models that offer refugees their full set of socio-economic rights. The right to work and choose a place of residence for refugees remain rare, and few donor countries have committed adequate resources to offer the promised benefits to host communities. Indeed, part of the reason why the model has been repeatedly revived by the international community, using different acronyms and monikers, is that it is an approach that is satisfyingly easy to articulate, but elusively difficult to implement. A big part of the gap, though, has been the absence of systematic learning. Initiatives have been tried, failed, forgotten, and then, after a brief interregnum, frequently revived. For example, at a global level, ICARA 1 and 2, Convention Plus, and the Solutions Alliance have all fallen by the wayside with little legacy, and yet the ideas within them have been recycled and reframed, usually with minimal adaptation. At a national level, particular contexts such as Uganda and Zambia have been framed as self-reliance successes, but often based on limited empirical evidence. Whether in academia or the policy world, there has been scant quantitative or even qualitative evidence about what actually works, for whom, and under what conditions. There is, therefore, an urgent need for a more evidence-based approach to thinking about the relationship between refugees and development. An evidence-based approach. My interest in researching the economic lives of refugees began more than two decades ago. One summer, while I was still a teenager and studying for an economics degree, I spent time doing voluntary work in a reception centre for asylum seekers and refugees in the Netherlands. I went not knowing a great deal about refugees. I had expected to experience a sense of pity for people who had had to flee war zones or tyrannical regimes around the world, but what I found was a sense of inspiration. I met people from as far afield as Iraq, Kosovo, and Liberia, and many had skills, talents, and aspirations. As I have recounted often, a Bosniak lawyer taught me the basics of public international law, and an Iranian former Olympian tried to teach me table tennis. But the tragedy was that these people were trapped in a bureaucratic process, unable to work until it had been determined whether or not they were refugees. Sometimes this process would take 3 or even 5 years, and at the end of that period, many families simply faced deportation. A system that denied talented people the possibility to work seemed to me to be inherently unfair, but it also struck me as economically absurd to leave people reliant on assistance when most wanted to make a social and economic contribution. That experience sent me back to my undergraduate university, determined to write a dissertation on the economics of refugees. And I did, but I was struck by how little literature and evidence there was on the economic lives of refugees, or even on the politics that shapes refugees' access to economic opportunity. Given the absence of research on the economics of refugees, or indeed relevant data sets that could be the basis for such work, I pivoted the early part of my academic career towards looking at the politics of refugee assistance. But during that period, I wrote about the history and politics of refugees and development and tried to understand the political conditions that made refugee self-reliance possible. Part of the motivation for this research was that as I travelled across Africa for research, the same tragedy I had witnessed in the Netherlands a decade earlier was being repeated. Refugees with skills and talents were being denied the right to work. However, after spending a year as a postdoc at Stanford, surrounded by the startups and social enterprises of Silicon Valley, I realized that markets as well as states needed to be part of the solution for refugees. They were, after all, the source of jobs that so many refugees had told me they wanted. It was time to go back to economics. When I returned to Oxford in 2012, I set up the basis of what became the Refugee Economies Programme at the university. We began with a pilot study in Uganda a year later. We chose to focus on Uganda not because it was representative of refugee hosting countries, but because it was exceptional in having given refugees access to the right to work and choose their residence. And we wanted to try to quantify some of the effects of giving refugees basic socio-economic freedoms. What happens when refugees are economically included and given access to enabling environments? What are the consequences for both refugees and the host community? The so-called European refugee crisis of 2015 to 2016 created a huge upsurge in public interest in refugees. With it came greater interest in evidence-based solutions. Perhaps reflecting the general absence of quantitative or comparative research on refugees, there was huge interest in the few such studies available, our research in Uganda, which received extensive media coverage because it used a combination of data and human stories to highlight what policymakers had known intuitively for a long time. One of the best ways to create sustainable refugee policies was to create enabling environments, including opportunities for economic inclusion, close to home. but our first findings were based on just one country, and not even a complete picture of that country, having focused just on the capital city and settlements in only one of the two major refugee-hosting regions of the country. In that context, the IKEA Foundation, the largest private sector contributor to the UN's refugee response, provided us with a grant to scale the research of the Refugee Economies Programme. This time we focused on urban and camp contexts in three countries, Uganda, Kenya, and Ethiopia. We chose these countries in order to have a meaningful regional focus and be able to compare outcomes for some of the same refugee populations, such as Congolese and Somali refugees, across different countries. Furthermore, these countries have long hosted significant numbers of refugees. In 2020, they hosted around 2.5 million refugees, about 10% of the world's total number of refugees. The countries also happen to be particularly interesting because they exhibit variation in terms of the institutional and structural environments they create for refugees' economic lives. Uganda has offered refugees the right to work and freedom of movement since independence. Kenya has a long-standing encampment policy towards refugees. Ethiopia has recently begun to transition from encampment towards offering the right to work. Our overall research objective was to understand the economic lives of refugees and their impact on the nearby host communities. More specifically, though, three fundamental questions animated our work, all with a clear relationship to the question of sustainability. First, what explains welfare outcomes for refugees and host communities? Put simply, when do some people thrive and others merely survive? Second, what explains social cohesion between refugees and host communities? Put simply, when do refugees and hosts get along and when do they not? Third, what explains onward migration? Put simply, when do refugees remain in camps or settlements and when do they move onwards to cities, other nearby countries, or even move onwards to rich countries? Up to that point, academic research on refugees was, with a few notable exceptions, generally qualitative and focused on single country cases. Meanwhile, policy research often used quantitative methods, but applied different methods in different countries, making meaningful comparison difficult. Our approach was a mixed methods, participatory approach. We sequenced qualitative and quantitative research in each research site. Beginning with qualitative research allowed us to first understand and build relationships within communities before designing and implementing quantitative survey methods. A particular feature of our research has been training refugees and members of the host community as peer researchers and enumerators. Through our research, we have trained over 200 members of the communities in basic social science methods. Through our survey data collection, we created one of the first ever panel data sets, data that is both multi-country and recorded over time, relating to the economic lives of refugees. Between 2017 and 2020, we collected first-hand data on the economic lives of 16,000 refugees and nearby host community members in six main research sites: Kampala and Nakivale in Uganda, Nairobi and Kakuma in Kenya, and Addis Ababa and Dolo Ado in Ethiopia. The resulting refugee economies dataset was unique in covering refugees and hosts, urban and camp contexts, and following some of our respondents over time. Our quantitative data was based on random sampling, allowing it to be representative of our populations of interest. The refugee economies dataset is wide-ranging. It covers areas as diverse as employment, income and assets, education, health, social participation, migration history, aspirations, and refugee host community perceptions and interactions. It enables a range of patterns, correlations and statistical relationships to be explored, whether through descriptive statistics or regression analysis. The data can be analyzed for particular sites or populations, or comparatively across contexts and populations. Overall, it can give us an insight into the factors that shape socioeconomic outcomes for refugees and the nearby host communities. These insights can, in turn, shed light on the kinds of policies that might lead to normatively better socioeconomic outcomes. And through comparison across contexts, it can also give us some insights into the impact that different institutional environments have on refugees' outcomes, behaviors, and choices. And we have also used the data to complement specific impact evaluations, examining, for example, the effects of innovative interventions such as cash-based assistance in the new Kalabai settlement in Kenya, or the establishment of agricultural cooperatives in the Dolo Ado camps in Ethiopia. In other words, our economic analysis can contribute towards an evidence-based understanding of what works, under what conditions, and for whom. But what it cannot do is tell us about the politics of how it can be made to work. There has been a long-standing gap in high-quality comparative political research relating to refugees. What configurations of interests, power, and ideas are necessary for progressive, or indeed sustainable, policies to be implemented? These questions matter, because they can teach us about the incentives needed to facilitate self-reliance. I have tried to complement the refugee economies research with an additional focus on the politics of economic inclusion. Under what conditions do host governments give refugees access to socio-economic rights, such as the right to work? When and why are self-reliance policies adopted in lieu of encampment policies? I have therefore supplemented our economic analysis with political analysis. Between 2018 and 2019, I undertook British Academy-funded research in our three focus countries to explore the politics of self-reliance. What incentives are needed at the local and national levels to persuade host governments to socio-economically integrate refugees? And when are international donors willing to provide such incentives? Our three focus countries are of particular relevance for exploring these questions because Uganda has a long-standing commitment to self-reliance. Kenya insists refugees live in camps, but in practice has begun to adopt elements of the Ugandan model in one particular part of the country. Ethiopia has recently passed legislation allowing refugees to work and move freely, but has yet to implement that legislation. Understanding the politics of socio-economic rights within these countries can therefore offer insights into the carrots and sticks that are needed to persuade host governments to adopt better policies. Focusing on the economics and politics of refugee self-reliance in just three countries cannot provide all the answers. The context in East Africa is not the same as in other parts of the continent, let alone the Middle East, Asia, or Latin America. Nevertheless, it provides a starting point for learning lessons about the political economy of self-reliance from three host countries that have, unlike most others, taken steps towards better integrating refugees. This book and its argument. This is, therefore, a book with a practical focus on what works. Its approach might be characterized as global challenge-led, rather than starting with a particular academic debate or trying to build incrementally on a body of knowledge. Its point of departure is to frame a real-world challenge and then draw upon interdisciplinary social science to seek answers. In this case, the practical question is, how can we create sustainable refugee policies that allow all refugees to live dignified and purposeful lives while carrying political support at local, national, and international levels? The underlying research draws upon theory and methods from a range of disciplines. The main two disciplinary approaches are economics and politics. However, I also draw upon ideas and methods from anthropology, sociology, and history. Across the chapters, the methods used are eclectic and include surveys, impact evaluations, intervention-based research, natural experiments, archival research, semi-structured interviews, participant observation, and focus groups. Some of the underlying research I did alone, notably chapters 8 to 11, much of it, notably chapters 3 to 7, relied upon building interdisciplinary research teams through the Refugee Economies program in order to collect data at scale. I divide the book into four main parts, covering ethics, economics, politics, and policy. Each one asks a question that contributes towards building an evidence base for the design of sustainable refugee policies. Part 1, covering ethics, asks, what is right? What, from a normative perspective, are the criteria for sustainable refugee policies? It outlines and defends the three main criteria, but also engages with possible normative critiques. Part 2, on economics, asks, what works? From the research that we have undertaken, what can we learn about best practices for supporting the socio-economic inclusion of refugees? What specifically can innovative models like the Ugandan self-reliance model, the designed Kalobai settlement in Kenya, and the private sector-funded Dolo Ado camps in Ethiopia teach us about the design of functioning refugee economies? Part 3 deals with politics and asks, what persuades? Under what conditions do host governments create the conditions for sustainable refugee economies to emerge? When do they provide refugees with socio-economic rights and opportunities? Finally, Part 4, policy, discusses what the research means for practice, explores its implications for other regions of the world, and unpacks how it relates to future trends in forced displacement. I argue that in an age of displacement, we need to find principled but pragmatic ways to provide refugee protection at scale. All countries have an ethical obligation and strategic interest to admit refugees onto their own territory, but solutions for the majority will be found in the low- and middle-income countries that neighbour conflict and crisis. In these countries, the socio-economic inclusion of refugees has the potential to be mutually beneficial for refugees, host communities, and governments. The key is a development-based approach to expand the socio-economic entitlements and capabilities of both refugees and the proximate host community, including through the right and opportunity to work, and through improved access to public services such as education and healthcare. Better socio-economic opportunities for refugees correlate with better welfare outcomes for refugees, improved social cohesion between refugees and hosts, and a reduced demand for onward migration. In cities, empowering refugees is about ensuring inclusion within existing economies. But urbanization alone is not the answer. In Ethiopia, Kenya, and Uganda, only a small minority of registered refugees live in cities. Many governments, including those in our three focus countries, are reluctant to tolerate urban refugees and impose significant restrictions. I show that refugees earn more, own more, and work more in the city, but they are not necessarily happier, healthier, or better fed than those who live in rural areas. Host communities in rural areas also tend to be more welcoming of refugees than in big cities, where social cohesion appears more elusive. There is therefore also a need to consider rural solutions for refugees, but which go beyond traditional encampment. In rural areas, the challenge is how to build viable economies in what are usually remote border regions. There are relatively few examples of attempts to systematically reimagine refugee camps in ways that are based on a development-based approach or that offer integrated, market-based opportunities to both refugees and the host community. Kelabai in Kenya and Doloado in Ethiopia are among the most striking examples anywhere in the world. Kelabai was designed as an integrated, market-based settlement for both refugees and hosts. Doloado benefited from the largest private sector investment ever received by a refugee camp and the rollout of a new model of cooperatives to enable refugees and hosts to work alongside one another. In both cases, I show that outcomes have been far from perfect, but both have made progress and offer opportunities to learn. In such contexts, refugee self-reliance is likely to remain elusive unless policymakers adapt their focus from small-scale livelihoods interventions towards recognizing the larger economic and political preconditions for building viable economies in remote border regions. On a political level, a crucial dimension of self-reliance has been securing the support of host governments. The politics of self-reliance is interest-driven. Donor governments have generally been prepared to fund self-reliance, insofar as it reduces long-term aid budgets or is believed to reduce onward migration. Host governments have been prepared to support the socio-economic inclusion of refugees, insofar as it attracts development resources that benefit host citizens and support elite patronage networks at national and local levels. For example, Uganda has consistently supported self-reliance because its politicians benefit from doing so. Since independence, it has used refugee self-reliance to attract international development assistance. Successive regimes have channeled some of these resources through patronage networks into strategically important refugee-hosting regions such as West Nile and the Southwest, reinforcing central government authority. Across each of our focus countries, socio-economic opportunity has opened up, mainly insofar as potential gatekeepers and veto players at national and local levels have been effectively bought off with international resources. These ambiguous politics, I argue, are a reality of global refugee politics, and they need to be understood. Above all, though, I suggest that the key to unlocking sustainable solutions for refugees is to recognize and build upon the capabilities of refugees themselves. Of course, many refugees have vulnerabilities, but like all human beings, most also have the potential to contribute economically, socially, and culturally, if given the opportunity. Part 1. Ethics. What is right? 2. The search for sustainability. Introduction. What does sustainability mean in the refugee context? It is a term frequently used in development and environmental contexts. In the broadest sense, sustainability implies the ability to endure over time. Sustainable policies are those that can be maintained without unravelling due to resource constraints in the future, whether those constraints are environmental or political, for example. The language of sustainability has been used in the broader migration context. A debate about sustainable migration has arisen in the context of the political backlash against immigration in rich societies across Europe and North America. There are growing concerns about brain drain from developing countries and the erosion of migrant rights around the world, including through the loss of life due to dangerous journeys and restrictive border practices. Marta Erdal and her colleagues define sustainable migration as migration that ensures a well-balanced distribution of costs and benefits for the individuals, societies, and affected states today and in the future. They highlight the multidimensional nature of the concept as requiring political, economic, social, and cultural sustainability across societies in countries of origin, transit, and destination. This offers a useful starting point, but defers the question of what that well-balanced distribution needs to look like in order to avoid significant political backlash. In response, I argued with Paul Collier that sustainable migration is inherently political and ethical. Sustainable migration policies must have the democratic support of the receiving society, meet the long-term interests of the receiving state, sending society and migrants themselves, and fulfill basic ethical obligations. Sustainability, though, means something different in the distinctive context of refugee policy. The need to consider what sustainability means in relation to refugees was brought to the fore by the political response to the European refugee crisis of 2015 to 2016, when more than 1 million asylum seekers arrived in the European Union, EU. The combination of numbers, incoherent policy responses, and irresponsible political rhetoric contributed to political backlash. Asylum and immigration became the most salient political issue in the many EU countries. A backlash against open-door asylum policies took hold. In Germany, Chancellor Angela Merkel initially pronounced, "Wir schaffen das," we can do it, in August 2015. But by early 2016, she had been forced to backtrack, close borders, and work with Turkey and the Balkan countries to reduce the onward movement of Syrian refugees. Tipping points were reached across Europe as opportunistic and populist politicians used refugee and migration movements as a scapegoat for broader societal issues. The refugee crisis offered a rallying call for populist politicians to mobilise voters affected by deeper socio-economic issues such as austerity and the loss of labour-intensive manufacturing jobs to automation and offshoring. From Brexit in the UK to the rise of the far-right alternative für Deutschland in Germany, the refugee crisis contributed to the unravelling of democratic institutions as populists across Europe made strikingly similar arguments about the impact of refugees and migrants on the economy, security, and identity. Far-right candidates were elected to national parliaments in practically every EU member state. Emboldened by seeing the electoral rewards of anti-asylum and immigration rhetoric, US politics soon followed. It is not just rich countries that face challenges of political sustainability. In 2016, Kenya threatened to close the Dadaab refugee camps and expel Somali refugees amid public backlash following a series of Somali-perpetrated terrorist attacks in the country. Since the start of the Syrian conflict, Lebanon has hosted the highest number of refugees per capita in the world, but with high numbers perceived to affect citizens' access to employment and public services, it closed its border with Syria in 2018 and has been accused of forcibly repatriating Syrian refugees. Opinion polls across Latin America reveal that countries hosting large numbers of Venezuelan refugees, from Ecuador to Peru, have suffered a collapse in political support for open policies as numbers have risen and created competition for jobs and services. What does this mean in terms of how we think about sustainability? Under what conditions does backlash arise? Are there clear thresholds and tipping points that undermine public support? To what extent should we take into account the risk of backlash when designing refugee policies, or does doing so risk rewarding populist opportunism? There are no hard and fast rules in terms of the relationship between numbers and backlash. Some societies can tolerate higher numbers than others. Germany, Uganda, and Jordan have coped remarkably with hosting significant numbers of refugees. Others, Japan, the Gulf states, and the Visegrad countries, Czech Republic, Hungary, Slovakia, and Poland, have a strikingly low acceptance of refugees on their territory. Others, such as Denmark and Tanzania, for example, have transitioned from being historically tolerant societies towards having much more pervasive anti-refugee sentiment. And even within the same societies, degrees of tolerance may ebb and flow over time, depending on the wider socio-economic and political context. The US showed remarkable tolerance towards immigration throughout the early 20th century, but then underwent a backlash in the late 1920s amid recession. West Germany tolerated large numbers of guest workers throughout the 1960s, and then abolished the scheme amid the economic consequences of the 1973 oil crisis. But despite geographical and temporal variation, there is, sadly, a pattern that occurs as societies receive high numbers of refugees. As numbers rise, opportunistic politicians tend to make the same three arguments relating to the economy, security, and identity. Refugees are portrayed as a source of competition, threat, or difference, and over time, opinion polls often shift against support for refugees, leading towards policies that frequently include border closure or deportation. We see this pattern for Europe, for the Syrian influx in the Middle East, and for the Venezuelan crisis in Latin America, for example. However, the relationship between numbers and public opinion is not a deterministic one. It is mediated by at least two sets of factors. First, whether there are potential sources of grievance between refugees and hosts, such as whether the economy can absorb a significant expansion in labour without displacing native jobs, whether there is a history of refugee-related violence or insecurity in hosting areas, and whether there is perceived cultural proximity or distance between hosts and refugees. Second, whether mitigating policies are introduced to enable host communities to share in the benefits of receiving refugees through, for example, additional investment in creating jobs and improving public services. In this context, what do normative criteria for sustainability look like? In other words, what would just or ethical principles for sustainability be? My starting point is to ground this chapter in what moral philosophers call non-ideal theory as opposed to ideal theory. Ideal theory attempts to explore what a just world should look like. It assumes that if the moral argument is strong enough, there can be strict compliance with its implications. The boundaries for what is ethical have to remain within the boundaries of what is possible under favourable circumstances. In contrast, proponents of non-ideal theory argue that knowing what an ideal society would look like is simply not helpful as a guide to action in the real world. In the words of Matthew Gibney, criticality requires feasibility. Put simply, making claims about how the world should look requires us to know what options are actually available to us in the real world, and this entails engaging with the constraints of politics, the political needs to be a central part of applied moral reasoning. Within political theory, there are long-standing debates on how we should understand the political constraints of applied morality. For the purposes of this chapter, I follow a tradition of political realism. Sustainable refugee policies must be reconcilable with politics. But which political constraints are real, and which ones are merely the narratives and rhetoric of opportunistic political elites? From this perspective, it may be worthwhile to distinguish between hard and soft constraints, those that we can change through argumentation or negotiation, and those that we cannot. Simply because we would like all countries to open their borders to refugees under all circumstances and accord a full set of civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights does not mean it will happen. But it does not necessarily make those arguments redundant if, under certain conditions, they actually contribute to change. Political realism does not therefore mean that arguments based on ethics, values, and norms cannot sometimes succeed in changing the attitudes of political elites towards refugees. But their degree of relevance is an empirical question, and to effect change in the real world, we need to take seriously the reality that many political elites perceive hosting large numbers of refugees as a cost. Against this backdrop, improving outcomes for refugees requires that we engage with the empirical reality of rising numbers, geographical concentration in low and middle-income countries, and increasing political hostility on a global scale. It necessitates that we find creative ways to reconcile refugee policy with power and interests at global, national, and local levels. Based on these premises, I outline three normative criteria for sustainability: rights, politics, and scale. First, sustainable policies must ensure that refugees have access to protection, assistance, and solutions. Second, they must be acceptable to political elites at the global, national, and local levels. Third, they must function at scale and endure as numbers increase. Put simply, the challenge is, how can we enable refugees to receive access to their full set of rights while maintaining political support and operating at the scale required in an age of displacement? I argue that the only realistic way to meet these criteria is by creating a model based primarily on supporting refugees in neighboring low- and middle-income countries close to home. But it requires significant investment in area-based development to create opportunities for both refugees and host communities to access meaningful employment and public services, ensuring that refugees can live with dignity and purpose until they can either go home or it becomes clear that they need to be integrated elsewhere. It also requires that such approaches are complemented by the availability of resettlement to rich countries around the world, albeit for a minority of refugees and for clearly defined reasons, as a route out of limbo when repatriation is not possible, as an alternative option for the most vulnerable, or for other reasons linked to family unity, employment, or educational opportunity. And it requires a supplementary role for spontaneous arrival asylum in the rich world as a check and balance for refugees unable, for whatever reason, to access asylum in a neighboring country. I structured this chapter around three main parts. First, I derive and explain the normative criteria for sustainability in the refugee system. Second, I outline three archetypal models for allocating responsibility for refugees, suggesting that they have complementary but distinctive roles to play in achieving sustainability. Third, I engage with three possible objections to this vision of sustainability. Normative criteria for sustainability. The three starting premises for my analysis are those I outlined in the introduction, relating to geography, numbers, and politics. First, most refugees are located in low- and middle-income countries that neighbour areas of conflict and crisis, and this will remain the case. Specifically, 85% of refugees come from such countries, and although there has been variation in this figure over the past three decades, it has consistently been above 70%. Second, the numbers of displaced people are going to grow over time in the context of fragile states and climate change. Specifically, numbers have risen year on year for the last 5 years and are the highest since the Second World War, while the World Bank estimates 143 million people will be displaced by climate change by 2050. Third, the political willingness of rich countries to accept large numbers of displaced people onto their territory will remain limited for the foreseeable future. Specifically, resettlement numbers for refugees have been consistently limited to 1-2% of the world's total refugees. While public attitudes towards spontaneous arrival asylum in the US and Europe have generally been positive when numbers have remained low. In general, attitudes to asylum and immigration in rich countries have been negatively affected by wider economic trends, including the collapse of labour-intensive manufacturing jobs in Europe and North America. These three trends are not necessarily inevitable, but they are extremely likely to continue, and so they represent my starting assumptions for thinking about sustainability in a non-ideal world. Any realistic theory of sustainability has to work within these constraints. Based on these premises, I outline three criteria for sustainability: rights, politics, and scale. Rights. Sustainable refugee policies must first and foremost fulfill the core purpose of refuge: to ensure that refugees receive access to their rights as both refugees and human beings. States have individual and collective duties towards refugees. These can be derived from a number of ethical perspectives. This starting point is the idea that all human beings, by virtue of their common humanity, have a right to have rights. Some rights, such as basic security, basic subsistence, and basic liberty, are basic insofar as, without them, it is impossible to enjoy any other rights. It is the primary duty of an individual's country of citizenship to ensure those rights. However, when that state is unable or unwilling to provide those rights, that is, that person faces persecution or serious harm, and they are outside their country of origin, that is, the person is in a situation often described as alienage, responsibility passes to the wider international community or whichever country that person is in. For political theorists, the moral basis for this transfer of responsibility is debated. For some, it is grounded in a humanitarian obligation, a duty of rescue that human beings have towards strangers in extreme and urgent need. For others, it is grounded in obligations that nation-states have simply in order to be regarded as legitimate actors within the international state system. If a premise of the international state system is that everyone should have a right to be a member of a state somewhere in the world, then legitimate states have an obligation to ensure membership is universally available. In practice, these two perspectives are compatible and can be reconciled by distinguishing the particular circumstances of different groups of refugees. In the event that people flee a state that persecutes them because of who they are, there may be no prospect of re-establishing the assumed relationship between state and citizen, and so an alternative citizenship may be required. In the event that people flee generalized violence or a temporary crisis, the forms of protection and membership required may not necessarily entail citizenship. States should be collectively prepared to contribute by providing access to territory or money towards ensuring these ethical obligations are fulfilled. The duty to protect the rights of people who flee and to provide them with a pathway toward effective citizenship are a shared responsibility between the country to which a refugee flees and the wider international community. The responsibility should not exclusively lie with the immediate neighbouring first country of asylum, simply because of the accident of geography of being next door to a crisis country. Philosophers disagree on the extent to which these duties are absolute or contingent. For Peter Singer and Renata Singer, given the extreme vulnerability of refugees, receiving countries and international donors should be willing to support refugees all the way up to the point at which the marginal benefit to the refugee is equivalent to the marginal cost to the receiving citizen. For others, such as Matthew Gibney, this demand is too onerous. A more realistic standard would be for governments to be obliged to help insofar as the cost of doing so is relatively low. Generally, when there is international cooperation and global responsibility sharing, this is a moot point, as the cost of providing refugee rights usually remains low. It is in the absence of international cooperation that particular states and their citizens are more likely to bear an unduly heavy cost by hosting refugees. If we accept the premise that states have obligations towards refugees by virtue of our common humanity, then what, specifically, does a sustainable refugee system have to provide? Three things: protection, assistance, and solutions. Protection is a contested term, but at a minimum, it implies ensuring that refugees are not forcibly sent back to a country in which they may face serious harm, and instead can live in safety and receive access to their civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights. Assistance implies having access to basic services such as in health, education, and basic welfare provision for the most vulnerable. But, like any functioning welfare system, assistance should encourage the attainment of autonomy over time. Solutions relate to the durable solutions of repatriation, resettlement, or local integration. A pathway to reintegration within a state system and a route towards effective citizenship within a timely period, whether back home or elsewhere. Put simply, any sustainable refugee system should be providing these three things to all refugees. However, there are other things that, although desirable insofar as they may improve welfare and are compatible with the other criteria of sustainability, are not core to the purpose of the refugee system. For example, giving refugees free choice in their final destination may be inherently worthwhile insofar as it increases well-being without jeopardizing sustainability. But it is neither a human right nor central to the ethical scope and purpose of a refugee system. It should therefore not be prioritized over and above creating a sustainable system that provides protection, assistance, and solutions for all refugees. Politics. To be sustainable, a refugee system must retain political support at international, national, and local levels. However, around the world, asylum and immigration have become politically divisive issues, and there are common patterns to the politics of backlash. As numbers rise, populist politicians mobilize based on an anti-immigration platform. Often, public concern has little to do with refugees or migrants per se, but it frequently serves as a proxy issue for other underlying grievances, such as the loss of labour-intensive manufacturing jobs or cuts to public services. Across Europe, North America, and Australasia, The last decade has seen a rise in the political salience of asylum and immigration, and that rising salience has usually been associated with a populist backlash against progressive asylum and immigration policies, which in turn has influenced mainstream government policies, reducing the scope for welcoming and integrating refugees. In the aftermath of the European refugee crisis of 2015 to 2016, there was a seismic shift in the politics of immigration. Germany received the largest number of refugees, more than 1 million across the 2 years. Initially, in late August 2015, Chancellor Angela Merkel proclaimed "Wir schaffen das." She suspended implementation of Europe's Dublin regulations that assign responsibility for asylum claims to the first countries of arrival, allowing mainly Syrian refugees to cross into Germany from Austria and other neighbouring countries. The open-door policy was initially hailed as progressive. However, the approach did not last. By early 2016, the mood in the country had changed dramatically. The media and other politicians began to question the sustainability of the open-door policy. On New Year's Eve, a series of attacks that the media falsely alleged were carried out by Syrian men against German women exacerbated the shift in public opinion. By late January, Merkel had backtracked and was forced to work bilaterally with other EU member states to close the Balkans route to Europe. She also began talks with Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan on a bilateral agreement, announced in March, to reduce onward movement by Syrian refugees and others coming mainly from Iraq and Afghanistan across the Aegean Sea. Within Germany itself, the Wir schaffen das moment quickly came to an end. The far-right Alternative für Deutschland party grew rapidly in popularity and won 90 seats in the Bundestag with 12.6% of the vote, based almost entirely on its campaigning around the impact of Merkel's briefly progressive refugee policies. Merkel later expressed regret at decisions regarding Germany's refugee policies of late 2015. According to Eurobarometer, migration was the single most important political issue to voters in Germany, Austria, the UK, Sweden, and Denmark by 2016, and the second most important issue in Italy. Across Europe as a whole, it became the single most important issue. Opinion polls also revealed a combination of increasing polarisation on attitudes to immigration and declining confidence in European governments' immigration policies. This rising political trend created political opportunities across Europe. Matteo Salvini's Northern League in Italy, Sebastian Kurz's People's Party in Austria, Nigel Farage's UK Independence Party, Marine Le Pen's Front National, Geert Wilders' Freedom Party in the Netherlands, for example, all mobilised primarily based on an anti-immigration platform that used the refugee crisis and the resulting increase in the political salience of migration as the basis for popular mobilisation. As these parties won votes, mainstream politics shifted to become ever more conservative in its asylum and immigration policies in order to combat the far right. Across the continent, Europe effectively closed its doors to refugees. European government policies converged around a series of common approaches. The focus was on irregular migration, including reducing the onward movement of asylum seekers. Internally, this involved a series of deterrence measures, such as a reduced welfare entitlements for asylum seekers and accelerated deportation for rejected claimants. Externally, this involved collaboration with Turkey and Libya to prevent the onward movement of asylum seekers across the Mediterranean. The European Commission's new Pact on Migration and Asylum, launched in September 2020, reflected these priorities. Although broad and wide-ranging, it emphasized the management of irregular migration, the rapid assessment and deportation of failed asylum seekers, and collaboration with transit countries outside the EU. In the US, politicization took place even without rising immigration numbers. Donald Trump mobilized electoral support in 2016 based on anti-immigration rhetoric, even at a time when U.S. Border Patrol apprehensions along the southern border, a long-standing indicator of irregular migration levels, were at a 20-year low. Trump used the European refugee crisis as a basis for his 2016 presidential election campaign, connecting Syrian refugees to terrorism and threats to national security. Within his first hour in office, he was promising a border wall with Mexico and large-scale deportation of illegal aliens. However, the political salience of immigration for U.S. voters rose further, only as the number of border apprehensions rose to record levels by 2019. In the year between September 2018 and September 2019, almost as many Central American asylum seekers tried to reach the U.S. as had come to Europe in 2015. A combination of violence, weak governance, and environmental stress led to a record number of asylum seekers heading north from the Northern Triangle countries of Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. As numbers rose, opinion polls turned against asylum seekers, and the Trump administration deployed increasingly restrictive policies, including incarcerating children and processing asylum applications in Mexico. The evidence suggests that underlying public grievances across the rich world have little to do with migration per se. For example, in the UK, Germany, and the US, there is a strikingly consistent geographical pattern to anti-immigration voting patterns and public opinion. The regions or voting districts with the greatest likelihood to vote for anti-immigration parties or to hold anti-immigration opinions tend to have two things in common. They have among the lowest levels of immigration, but they also tend to be the regions that have undergone industrial decline, losing labor-intensive manufacturing jobs to offshoring and automation. The pattern applies to the highest Brexit voting areas in the UK, hotbeds of Trump support in the US, and alternative für Deutschland strongholds in Saxony, for example. In this context, the political scope for welcoming or resettling large numbers of refugees in the rich world is extremely limited, and there seems little prospect of changing this in the short term, despite some indications of declining support for populist extremism in the US and elsewhere by 2020. This is because the politics of asylum and immigration in the rich world is being shaped by structural trends that are unlikely to lessen over time. Automation, the movement of labor-intensive manufacturing jobs to Southeast Asia, austerity, precarious financial markets, the rise of China, and recently COVID-19. Put simply, the West's relative economic decline has contributed to a populist politics with long-term implications for the viability of large-scale sanctuary in rich countries. But there is also empirical evidence that an open borders policy would change the demographic composition of rich countries. Given the opportunity, hundreds of millions of people around the world would migrate from poor to rich countries. Gallup has created a potential net migration index, which explores how much the population of a particular country would change if everyone who wanted to move actually moved where they wanted to. It showed, for instance, that the population of the US would increase by 46%, Canada by 147%, the UK by 37%, and Australia by 179%, while Mexico's would decrease by 20% and Ethiopia's by 27%. Indeed, the polling organization found that 42 million Latin Americans would like to move to the US. Of course, it is important to keep in mind the striking difference between people's wish to migrate versus the numbers that actually plan to migrate. However, the data on aspirations nevertheless highlights that in a world of economic inequality, a growing global youth population and rising aspirations, there is growing demand for South-North migration. Against this backdrop, rich countries can and should take in refugees, but the numbers that can be politically sustained are likely to be small. The difficulty is that political tipping points can also be observed in other parts of the world. From Latin America to the Middle East and Africa, the pattern of backlash is broadly the same. Numbers rise, political opinion turns negative, populist groups mobilize, and rights are restricted. The pattern may be mediated by other factors: labor market capacity, cultural proximity between refugees and hosts, policy choices, ratification of international legal instruments, and centralized governments with the capacity to override localized concerns. However, from Peru to Lebanon and Bangladesh to Tanzania, we have seen rising numbers of refugees gradually leading to backlash. And the main opportunity to mitigate this effect seems to have been significant external investment in employment and public services to the benefit of both refugees and host communities. To take an example, by 2019, 4.2 million Venezuelans had fled the country, with predictions suggesting the numbers would continue to rise. Across Latin America, initially generous and hospitable host country policies have been eroded by the same pattern. Numbers grow, jobs are displaced, stress is placed on public services, and communal tensions increase. This has turned opinion polls against refugees and brought xenophobic narratives into politics, creating pressure on mainstream politicians to implement more restrictive policies. At first, for instance, Peru opened its borders, allowing Venezuelans to apply for short-term stays or for asylum, and from January 2017 until December 2018, offering Venezuelan migrants temporary access to work, education, and banking services. But by the end of 2018, Peru suspended that practice amid concerns that it was creating an incentive for more Venezuelans to come. In 2017, Brazil began offering Venezuelan migrants a 2-year residency visa and gave all asylum seekers access to work permits and basic services. In 2018, however, the governor of Roraima State appealed to the Supreme Court to close the border until the conditions for humanitarian reception were in place. The case was dismissed by the Federal Supreme Court on the grounds of international legal obligations and constitutional provisions, but it exemplified a changing immigration politics in the country, with President Jair Bolsonaro withdrawing from the UN Compact for Safe, Orderly and Regular Migration in January 2019. Brazil has also tried, with limited success, to carry out an internal relocation scheme in which around 5,000 Venezuelans in the border area have been transferred to 17 other states across the country. For its part, Ecuador initially welcomed fleeing Venezuelans, but eventually introduced stricter border controls in August 2018. In January, the country witnessed a xenophobic backlash after a Venezuelan killed his pregnant Ecuadorian girlfriend. In the face of the resulting anger and violence, many Venezuelans left Ecuador for Colombia. Opinion polls revealed that throughout the region, the pattern has been a consistent shift between 2017 and 2019 from support for Venezuelan refugees and migrants towards support for more restrictive policies. Even Colombia, the most generous host country in the region, has followed the same pattern. Between 2017 and 2019, the country opened its doors to roughly 1.5 million Venezuelans and has granted them the right to work and to receive basic services through a registration and regularization program known as the Permiso Especial de Permanencia, PEP, P-E-P. However, with Venezuelans comprising 2.65% of the overall population, growing concern in border regions and cities about the displacement of Colombians from the informal economy and huge stress on public health and education provision. Opinion polls shifted from 70% to 49% approval for the government's open-door policy in the lead-up to the November 2019 local elections. The main means to mitigate this type of backlash appears to be external investment in jobs and public services for both refugees and citizens. Colombia, for instance, has complained that as a middle-income country, it has received just $300 million over 2 years for the refugee crisis, and this has mainly gone through international, non-governmental organizations, NGOs, rather than the government or private sector. This, the government argues, is well below 10% per capita of what Middle East countries received during the Syria crisis, and privately, Colombian government officials highlight that the lack of investment increases the risk of political backlash because of the displacement effect on employment and public service provision. Lebanon, the largest per capita refugee host in the world, has also faced a growing political backlash against refugees. It has experienced immense pressure on public services, including more than 300,000 Syrians entering the Lebanese school system, leading to citizens' children only accessing half-day schooling. By 2019, Foreign Minister Gebran Bassil was using increasingly nationalistic language and mobilizing against Syrian refugees with protest slogans such as "Employ a Lebanese," and "Syria, get out." Accordingly, Lebanon's security forces, called General Security, began implementing legal restrictions that had previously not been enforced, including closing down Syrian-owned shops and demolishing permanent refugee homes. Although the backlash was due to a combination of factors, such as austerity measures amid economic downturn and sectarian tensions, a major factor has been a sense of pressure on jobs, infrastructure, and public services for citizens, coupled with inadequate international assistance. Tanzania, host to 380,000 refugees, mostly from Burundi and the Democratic Republic of Congo, has historically been one of the most generous refugee-hosting countries in the world, despite being among the poorest 30 countries in the world. It pioneered rural self-reliance programs for refugees under Julius Nyerere and offered naturalization to tens of thousands of Burundians under Jakaya Kikwete. Since assuming power in 2015, though, President Magufuli has resorted to increasingly populist rhetoric on refugees, implementing a range of new restrictions, such as further limiting refugees' mobility and accelerating their repatriation. His justification has been the stress placed on infrastructure, the economy, and security in refugee-hosting regions such as Kigoma. He has further argued that, despite Tanzania's long-time commitment to hosting refugees, it has received limited international support, and members of the Tanzanian government can easily recite a catalogue of what they see as failures of international responsibility sharing. Indeed, during the anti-colonial liberation wars of the 1960s and 1970s, President Nyerere offered an open door policy to hundreds of thousands fleeing southern African neighbours. Refugees were given access to land, and it was one of the most progressive refugee hosting countries in the world. But when Tanzania finally approached international donors for support to make this approach sustainable at the International Conferences on Assistance to Refugees in Africa in 1981 and 1984, pledges were made by major donor countries that were not delivered. In the mid-1990s, when Tanzania received mass influxes from Burundi in 1993, and then over 250,000 Rwandans in just 3 days in 1994, it faced criticism for its forced repatriation of many Rwandans, but received only limited support. In 2008, it announced that it would naturalise 162,000 Burundian refugees who had arrived in 1972. Once again, commitments of international support went unfulfilled. By February 2018, Magufuli explained that against the historical backdrop, his government would withdraw from the UN Refugee Agency, UNHCR's Comprehensive Refugee Response Framework, CRRF, a key element of the Global Compact on Refugees. Bangladesh has been hosting growing numbers of Rohingya refugees fleeing crimes against humanity and accusations of genocide in neighbouring Myanmar since the 1990s, but the numbers have grown rapidly since 2017 to around 1 million. Almost all have settled in sprawling camps in the country's Cox's Bazar district. In some districts, refugees have outnumbered the local host population. The population increase has been identified as placing considerable pressure on the local employment market, infrastructure, and public services. The political mobilization of a minority of Rohingya within the camps through armed organizations engaged in cross-border incursions, such as the Arakan Rohingya Salvation Army, ARSA, ASA, have been viewed by the government as a security threat. Over time, there has been a growing political backlash, and politicians have responded with a clampdown. By 2019, the government imposed restrictions on movement, internet access in the camps, and began building barbed wire fences around the camps. It was also implicated in extrajudicial killings of refugees and has been pushing strongly for the repatriation of the Rohingya, even though UNHCR and others have insisted that it would be premature and unsafe for people to return home. These examples show that the commitment of neighbouring states to host refugees cannot be taken for granted. Maintaining host government support is critical to sustainability and requires significant investment in jobs, infrastructure, and public services. The capacity to maintain political support at international, national, and local levels has to be a key normative criterion for sustainability. Advocating for ideal policies that ignore political reality will simply lead to backlash and result in worse outcomes for refugee rights. However, in thinking about tipping points at which rising numbers lead to political backlash, it is also worthwhile to distinguish between hard and soft constraints. Simply because a populist politician represents a constraint as immovable does not mean this cannot be changed. But equally, just because a liberal politician represents a constraint as infinitely changeable does not mean that it can be ignored without consequence. The analytical challenge is to identify where and how politics can be changed, and where and how policy must adapt to the underlying politics. In some areas, appeal to values, changing narratives, and using ethical arguments may be persuasive over the long term. In other areas, the only means to achieve sustainability will be to work with prevailing power structures and interests and seek to reconcile refugee policy with realpolitik. Scale. The third criterion for sustainability is that refugee policies must be capable of enduring over time and functioning at scale. This is because all of the trends suggest displacement numbers will continue to rise. The 21st century will become an age of displacement. Of course, there are things that can be done to address the underlying causes: ending wars, rebuilding fragile states, combating climate change, strengthening human rights, and addressing global inequality would all significantly reduce future levels of displacement. But these are areas that the world is struggling with. Concerted collective action is proving elusive, and displacement is a symptom of a wider failure of international cooperation. We cannot know the future, but we can build scenarios based on current trends. Displacement numbers are rising year on year, and the biggest current driver is fragile states. A small number of chronically fragile countries, such as Syria, Afghanistan, and South Sudan, are a major source of displacement. However, new fragile states, such as Venezuela, Yemen, and Libya, increase displacement numbers each year. Refugee numbers are a subset of those displaced. Rising internal displacement leads many of those who can to cross international borders. A polarized UN Security Council thwarts international cooperation to address the underlying causes of state collapse. And the shift towards a multipolar world, which is likely to continue for the next 50 years or beyond, predicts continued polarization within the multilateral system, as well as violent proxy conflicts involving the world's great powers. Climate change is probably the biggest reason why an age of displacement looms on the horizon. Precise predictions about the impact on displacement are difficult, and a range of extrapolations have been made from 200 million by 2050 by the International Organization for Migration, IOM, to 143 million by 2050 by the World Bank. As one academic put it, some of these types of predictions rely upon heroic extrapolations. Although we know it will be severe, we do not know exactly what the scientific impact of anthropogenic climate change will be for displacement. There are a range of scenarios, but all involve rising sea levels, extreme weather events, desertification, flooding, and the transformation of habitats. We know that this will have social consequences in areas ranging from food security to livelihoods, albeit that the impact will vary with context and adaptation strategy. These social consequences will lead to impacts on mobility, migration, and displacement. From disappearing islands to natural disasters, people will be forced to flee. Furthermore, a significant impact of climate change will be its multiplier effects, exacerbating other drivers of displacement such as fragility and conflict. None of this is certain because climate change and its relationship to displacement are mediated by social and political choices, but it is likely. At the moment, the world is struggling to make sense of the changing drivers of displacement. Restrictive politics around the world has left little appetite on either the right or left to expand the categories of people with a human rights-based entitlement to migrate beyond existing legal definitions. As a result, the traditional refugee or economic migrant dichotomy dominates politics and policy making around the world, even though current drivers of displacement often defy simple categorization. The 1951 Convention definition of a refugee as someone fleeing based on a well-founded fear of persecution remains the primary standard. And although it is often interpreted in light of contemporary circumstances to include groups such as those fleeing generalized violence, bureaucratic and judicial interpretations adapt slowly and inconsistently, leaving significant gaps. I have used the term survival migration to describe people fleeing complex drivers of displacement in fragile states who do not neatly fit the definition of being either a refugee or an economic migrant. Their predicament is characterized by the interaction of weak governance, generalized violence, and food insecurity, for example. From Somalia to Afghanistan, an increasing proportion of the world's displaced fall into this category. Conditions make it impossible for many people to sustain the minimum conditions of human dignity without crossing a border, and yet many would not fit the 1951 Refugee Convention definition. I first used the term survival migration in the context of the exodus of Zimbabweans from Robert Mugabe's regime in the early 2000s. Between 2003 and 2010, around 2 million Zimbabweans fled across to South Africa and other neighboring states. Like Venezuelans today, for example, most were fleeing the economic consequences of the underlying political situation rather than political persecution per se. Basic services were no longer available. Poor governance and hyperinflation had ravaged the economy. People fleeing were faced with crime banditry in the border regions. In southern Africa, host states such as South Africa and Botswana could have invoked the 1969 Organization of African Unity, OAU, Refugee Convention definition of a refugee, as someone fleeing a serious disturbance to public order in whole or in part of the country. But politics and sheer numbers pushed against that, and, as in Latin America today, UNHCR lacked the capacity and resources to countenance a large-scale refugee response. It was only from 2010, after deporting literally hundreds of thousands of Zimbabweans back to Mugabe's regime, that a moratorium on deportation was put in place, but with virtually no additional assistance. Today, it is a trend we see elsewhere in the world. In the Central American context, what we have witnessed at the US's southwestern border is an archetypal example of survival migration. In 2019, an average of nearly 100,000 people per month are estimated to have left the Northern Triangle region of Central America for the US. This represented
more. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.